गुड इवनिंग वन एंड ऑल। आई डॉक्टर समर्पिता मुखर्जी वेलकम यू फॉर द कंक्लूडिंग सेशन ऑफ रिजनरेटिव मेडिसिन एंड स्टेम सेल थेरेपी। यस्टरडे इट वाज अ वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव सेशन। वी गॉट अ क्लियर आइडिया अबाउट स्टेम सेल, इंपॉर्टेंट फीचर्स एंड टाइप्स ऑफ स्टेम सेल्स, प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ सेल रिन्यूअल, गॉट टू नो अबाउट स्टेम सेल नीच, स्टेम सेल कल्चर। डॉक्टर सायंतन दास गुप्ता एक्सप्लेन्ड ईच ऑफ देम इन अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड लूसिड वे। Today we are continuing with remaining part of stem cell therapy. I request all the participants to mute their audio and post their queries in the chat box. Answers will be given at the end of the session. Due to time constraints, sir will be able to answer only 3 to 5 questions. For the rest, please mail them to our official mail address @sslmpofficials@gmail.com. Now, without wasting much time, I would like to invite Dr. Sayantan Das Gupta, Associate Professor of North Bengal Medical College and excellent academician, to continue his session and enrich us further on this topic. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Samarpita. So we can start again. Before that, I'd request Anil to please see. I cannot see my video window. Is it visible? Is my video window visible? Okay. So let's start again. In last class, we have discussed the basics of stem cell, that is the basic biology of stem cell and the how to culture stem cell and what environment or rather the micro environment that we discussed as the stem cell niche, how they are important in the regulation of stem cell maintenance and their functioning. So today, we are going to the topic that was our headline of the entire webinar, that is the therapeutic use of the stem cell, that is the stem cell therapy per se. So today we will discuss the stem cell therapies, what are the different researches that are going on. Obviously, we all know that in most of the cases, they are in research or trial level. So we will discuss them and what types of stem cells are used here, that we will discuss. Okay. So generally the strategies that we use for stem cell therapy are three types, mainly different strategies that we used. Okay. So the first is a direct administration. Whatever the tissue, if you want to use stem cell therapy for, we will discuss different clinical conditions. So say there is a patient of arthritis. So we want to do a regeneration of tissue there. So what we'll do, we'll directly inject the stem cell or progenitor cell directly in that damaged organ or that damaged tissue. So that is the first way that we can use. Matlab, in generalized way, right? Okay. Shei bhabe, we will just see three danger ways. The second one is transplantation of differentiated cell. Now this becomes interesting. Here what we do, we take stem cells from the stem cell cultures or the stem cell line, and then we differentiate them to different types of target cells that ultimately or tissue cells that we want to produce. That we were discussing in the last class, that not only the generation or maintenance of stem cells are important, it is also important while therapeutic use, how we can convert them back again to the target tissue as it will be used. So I want to mention one or two things here. The first thing is this differentiation that is done of the stem cells to be treated. This has a very interesting term that is known as directed differentiation. Directed differentiation is the term that we use. Okay. So as in the, from the previous classes knowledge, we can already have an idea that this directed differentiation has to have some relationship with the microenvironment and the niche of the stem cells in which they are there because it is the niche that interact with the stem cells and help in their self-renewal and differentiation both. So depending on what niche it is in or what niche interaction you are being able to stimulate, depending on that, a stem cell will differentiate into different types of mature or specialized cells. So it is, there are twofold things that we do. One is we modulate or regulate the niche in which the stem cell is there. And obviously then we can use specific maturation or specialization or differentiation signals. So depending on what cell signaling molecules we give, it will differentiate into different things. Again, I will not go into much detail of it, but I'll give just one or two examples. For example, one particular pathway, signaling pathway, I named yesterday that you all know, that is hedgehog pathway. So this hedgehog pathway, if through this pathway we can stimulate or differentiate a cell, it typically has been seen that motor neuron, okay, so that is one thing. And then there is another very interesting thing that has been found, that is retinoic acid, which we all know retinoic acid has a role, not retinal, the retinoic acid form has a role in differentiation and maturation of different cells. And it has indeed been found that it, if stem cells in typical niche, given the stimulus of retinoic acid, they can help in the regeneration of the retinal cells. So that again is very, very important, very interesting. And regeneration stem cell therapy with respect to the diseases of eye is very, very important. I will come to that later. And finally, the third thing is, the stimulation of endogenous stem cells. So when there is the stem cells, as we have seen that in adult tissue, there are different adult stem cells in different adult tissue anyway present. So if we can stimulate, not from outside, stem cell therapy does not necessarily mean that you will have to get stem cell from outside. Although typically that is what we mean, but the stem cells that are inside our body, if we can stimulate them, so that can also help in the regeneration of specific cells or tissues, etc. So we can stimulate them through growth factor, through drugs. One very, very common example will be giving erythropoietin, that we all know that is routinely given in certain hematological diseases, but the erythropoietin helps the hematopoietic stem cells to be stimulated to divide and differentiate. Okay, so these are the generalized way of looking at what are the strategies that we use for the stem cell therapy. Okay, so now moving forward, adult stem cells, we know there are many, many tissues. We have discussed in the previous class that there are many tissues where adult stem cells are already there: brain, liver, skin. Dental pulp is a very, very important tissue. Dental tissue, nowadays there has been many, many research, many articles. Will find that from dental tissue different types of stem cells are found. I'll come little bit to it later when we discuss tissue wise what are the therapeutic options we have. And then placenta, synovial fluid, heart, pancreas, intestine, we have discussed what are the different tissues where we can find the multipotent different stem cells, and then progenitor, unipotent, etc. So now the availability of stem cell for therapeutic use, the basic types of stem cells that can use, again that we have discussed, we are drawing it from the yesterday's discussion. It can be embryonic stem cell, they can be induced pluripotent stem cell, where you have the pluripotency like the embryonic cell, but you don't have the ethical dilemma of using cells from an embryo. Then umbilical cord is also a very good source for getting stem cells. They usually do not give you stem cells of pluripotent nature, but they often can give us stem cells of multipotency, and they can be used in different conditions. So umbilical cord stem cell is again a very important practical source of stem cell therapy. And then organ specific somatic stem cells, that is the adult stem cells basically. So these are the different types of sources from which we can get stem cells. Okay, so now one by one, if we just see them, embryonic stem cells we have already discussed yesterday. So unused human blastocyst. Obviously, when we take the cells from the inner cell mass, it will not be a viable embryo that is in a mother's womb. So where from we can get it? We will get it from the fertility clinic, where there is in vitro fertilization. Multiple such zygotes are formed, and only some of them will be implanted ultimately. So there will be some unused ones. From there only, the inner cell mass can be taken out. And while it has to be used on someone, there obviously has to be immunological competency and HLA matching, etc., before the transplantation you need to do. Then there is, for embryonic cell generation, other than from the inner cell mass, there is another very interesting technique, which I did not discuss yesterday. That is known as somatic cell nuclear transfer. Or in other words, it is also known as therapeutic cloning. So how do we do it? This is very interesting. What we do, we take a somatic cell and we take an egg cell. From the egg cell, the nucleus is removed. And the nucleus from the somatic cell is then transplanted on this egg cell. So the nucleus from the person whom you need to do the stem cell therapy and the egg cell from somewhere else. This egg cell will now produce clones, and they will obviously be of totipotent and then pluripotent nature. And from there, you can generate different types of cells of different lineage, and you can use them accordingly. Okay, so this is getting cells which are typically like the embryonic cells, but you are not getting them from embryo, but through a process known as somatic cell nuclear transfer. And then we come to the induced pluripotent stem cell, obviously, which we know is adult cell is reprogrammed to produce the pluripotent stem cell, like the pluripotent stem cells of the embryonic stem cells. And the four factors that are KLF4, OCT4, SOX2, and c-MYC. We have discussed, these are known as the Yamanaka factor. And they, when are given, they will reprogram our adult cell to pluripotent stem cell. So that is obviously a very good source. This is the thing, the Yamanaka factor given on the adult cell. Typically, fibroblasts can be other cells also, and then pluripotent stem cells are formed. Now, coming to the umbilical cord stem cells, they are typically not of the pluripotency level of the iPSC or ESC, but they are typically of sometimes maybe multipotent or even progenitor cell level, but still they are available very easily. There is no risk of the graft versus host if you can store it and use it on the same person. And there is very less risk of getting contaminated with any zoonotic diseases, zoonotic sources, and some other things, to which the zoonotic disease, we will again come back later, that comes with respect to the culture of these stem cells that we discussed. So umbilical cord stem cell is a very practical source of getting some progenitor kind of cells. Now, in pharmacological field, other than the therapeutic use for one particular disease, there is another very interesting thing. From stem cell, we can generate different types of cell lines, different adult cells or other types of cells, whatever types of cells we want. And then for drug testing and safety testing, we can do easily on those cell lines without going to the animal model or for human test. For example, for hepatocyte drug toxicity testing, if you want to, we can just generate the hepatic cell lines from specific stem cells through specific signals and niche manipulation, and we can do drug testing jolly well. Then cancer cell also, we can generate some cancer cell by reprogramming, and then we can use some anti-cancer drugs. So these use of drugs or drug testing before the animal or human model, this is a very, very interesting source or use of stem cells actually. Now, therapeutic, now coming to the main topic, that is the, what are the therapeutic use of stem cells? We need to remember that in most of the cases, the established treatment protocol is not much large. There will be only few where the stem cell use of stem cell as a therapy is established as an acceptable method, not as a research method. So the protocol, some kind of protocol formation, etc. That is one where the treatment is established. Then there is another large group where they are under human trial. They are being used for human disease on humans, but still in the trial stage. And then there are some even larger group where these stem cells are used trial on the animal model. So these are the three groups under which. So when we say that stem cells are used for these diseases, we need to remember only some of them are used as some kind of established treatment. But many of them are still under human trial, some under animal trial. So one by one, we will just mention some from each group. So currently established treatment protocol is there for certain diseases. So let us first enlist them, some of them. The first thing is there is very few accepted therapies that can be called they are established. But first among them obviously will be bone marrow transplant, which is established long time back. So that is again a type of stem cell therapy. Then I was mentioning that role of stem cell therapy on diseases of eye, mainly on corneal and retinal diseases, age-related macular degeneration and corneal damage leading to loss of vision. These two diseases, eye diseases, these two ophthalmologic diseases, they have been found to have some very, very promising results on stem cell therapy. Then mesenchymal stem cells, they can be transplanted to repair some chondral defects, some cartilage defects, and very, very interestingly, in osteoarthritis. In osteoarthritis, stem cell therapy has had certain trials, and those trials have very promising results. And then we have the cardiomyocytes. They have been seen to be regenerated, and that has been seen to have some very promising result in ischemic and other types of cardiomyopathy. Some specific examples, again, I will come later on. So these are some of the examples where it is more or less established, and some good data we already have on the result of the stem cell therapy. Next, we go to the diseases where there are human trial going, still not very well established. Some of the degenerative brain diseases like Parkinsonism, Alzheimer's, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, etc. Then in stroke patient, again, on brain disease, the neuronal regeneration, there has been seen that oligodendrocyte progenitor cell, they have developed from the human embryonic stem cells. And then in stroke patients and in spinal cord injuries, these cells have been used. Like we mentioned, that cardiomyocytes for cardiac diseases, like even acute myocardial infarction also, that is under the trial stage. Cardiomyopathy, it is somewhat established. Acute myocardial infarction, it is under trial. Then lung diseases like pulmonary fibrosis, COPD. Then liver tissue. There has been a lot of work on the regeneration of liver tissue and liver transplantation from regeneration of liver from the stem cell after liver tissue damage, hepatic failure, and other forms of liver cirrhosis, etc. And there is some very interesting findings with respect to treatment of alopecia. Okay. So these are some of the areas where human trial is going on. Again, I want to mention or clarify one thing, that I could only enlist some of them. There are many, many other diseases, and every day there has been some more progress has been going on. So something that I have enlisted under the animal trial may have well been under human trial in some places. So that thing I should clarify first. So this is whatever I could have gathered. So then there are some diseases which are under animal model trial. So burn wounds, I will show a diagram where burn wounds in animal model, there is very good result in the healing of burn wounds by trial with stem cell therapy. Then teeth, dental tissue. Again, there has been a lot of work going on the dental tissue, their regeneration. And in fact, stem cell are also found from dental tissue in both ways, dental tissue regeneration and stem cell from dental tissue, both ways the work is going on. The neural deafness and then diabetes. There has been a lot of work going on in treatment of diabetes with these stem cells where specifically in the type 1 diabetes, where the beta cells are destroyed. So regenerated beta cells that can be transplanted, or stem cells are transplanted that regenerate the beta cells in the pancreas. So now we come to some of the specific examples. So let's start with the ophthalmological examples, the examples of eye disease. In 2005, it is the example I'm giving is not very recent. There has been a lot more work in later times also. But as an example, in 2005, in the Queen Victoria Hospital in UK, almost 40 patients, it was not a very small patient number, 40 patients, they have been found to gain a very significant level of vision. They had corneal injury. What was done? From the cornea, there was stem cells were collected and that were transplanted into the corneal tissue. And the damaged cornea were repaired and eventually vision restored. So this is very, very heartening result. Not only corneal damage, again, there are results from certain trials that macular dystrophy, macular degeneration, they also has shown measurable improvement, significant improvement in their vision after 3-4 months, and that maintained, that regained vision maintained after the stem cell therapy. Here though, it was the study I'm quoting, only 2 patients we have seen, but in the meantime, the study has also progressed. Other patients also have been tried. In fact, our article has been published in Lancet in 2012 in the Jules Stein Eye Institute. They have been seen that one woman who has gone legally blind from macular degeneration, there has been a dramatic improvement in the vision and the dramatic improvement in the acuity of vision. And again, what we did, there was embryonic stem cell transplantation. So eye diseases have shown some significant improvement with stem cell therapy. Both the two major areas where has been regeneration, cornea and retina. Okay. Now orthopedics, I was mentioning that the osteoarthritis, direct injection, one of the methods we have mentioned, direct injection of the stem cell in the knee osteoarthritis, and there has been MRI evidence that there has been improved, increased cartilage, increased meniscus volume, and the knee arthritis is improved. And there has been a large number of patients who have undergone this study, and there has been very, very promising result in this field. Then cardiomyopathy, as we mentioned, that there has been embryonic stem cell therapy in guinea pigs in 2012 and later in human also, that there has been regeneration of cardiomyocytes. One case report I will try to present in front of you, just mention, I will not go in detail, that there was a 4-year-old girl, Angela Irizarry, in Connecticut. She was suffering from a life-threatening cardiomyopathy. And then in Yale University, her bone marrow stem cells, her own bone marrow stem cells were taken out, and that were grown to form a new blood vessel, which bypassed the defective heart part. And Angela, till now, whatever we know, she is still doing well. So the jury is still out in open, but there is some promising results in heart disease also, directly cardiomyocyte regeneration and some other very, very unique ways of regenerating blood vessel, etc., in the cardiac tissue. So these are some of the very, very heartening results in heart disease also. Then, as we were mentioning, in brain disease, in neurodegeneration, brain death, spinal brain, not brain death, the death of neuronal cells in brain and spinal cord, loss of neurons, loss of oligodendrocytes, there has been some clinical trials. This is one in 2013 that was done in Scotland. Stem cells were injected in the brains of stroke patients. There has been some improvement found, but still, again, the study is going on and results will come out, but the preliminary results in all these cases are very, very promising, and that's why we are presenting them. Okay, in neurodegeneration cases, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis patient, there has been an FDA-approved trial in 2010, and stem cell injected in the lumbar and cervical regions, and this study started in 2012. Again, the preliminary results are promising, but still the jury is out. Okay, So in neurodegeneration, that field also, there has been some very, very promising results, and we are all waiting how it goes forward. Then neural deafness. In stem cell in cochlea, we can see these are the fluorescently tagged stem cells that have been given, and there has again been some reports. Heller, there are many, many studies. I will just cannot mention all of them, but some of them that there has been shown success in regrowing the cells in the cochlea, where it leads to some level of improvement in neural deafness, which is again a very, very promising thing. Now coming to the burn wound healing, specifically in the burn wound, I was mentioning that in this is mainly going on in the animal model right now. So what happens here, the damaged tissue, the tissue, say the burn tissue that is damaged, that is taken as the soil on which the stem cells will be given as seeds. And very interestingly, depending on that soil, the niche, the microenvironment of that soil, they will provide the signal for these seeds to grow into a typical way so that there is wound bed healing. Okay. In one trial, the mesenchymal stem cells have been isolated from the Wharton's jelly of umbilical cord and then injected directly into the wounds. And again, there has been very promising results with re-epithelialization of the wounds. I would like to give an example of one study on animal model. As you can see, this is an animal model study. There is a burn. Normally, the treatment, normally without the umbilical, without the stem cell therapy, see, this is when the burn happened. And after 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 6, 8, and 11 weeks, this is how the burn is healing. The healing is very slow and there is many scar tissue, etc. formed. Now, the same thing when tried with a umbilical cord mesenchymal stem cell, HUCMSC, human umbilical cord mesenchymal stem cell, that has been given after the birth. And see, from the 3-6 weeks, we have seen that there is significant improvement in the healing of birth. And after 10-11 weeks, you can see there is a drastic difference between the animal that has been treated with stem cells and the animal that has not been treated with stem cells. So that is very, very, again, a very significant, promising, and encouraging result. Then hepatic stem cells. Mesenchymal stem cell directly can inhibit the activation of hepatic stellate cells. Okay, the main cells of the extracellular matrix via different pathways. Again, I will not go into detail, but there is a potential that they can form the hepatic cells. And how we can generate them? Again, from the embryonic stem cell, we separate the embryonic stem cell from here, the inner cell mass, as we discussed yesterday. Then we, with presence of specific niche and microenvironment and giving some specific differentiation signals, we will convert them to committed cell, then to immature and finally mature hepatocyte, and that can be used for transplantation and, as we have discussed, for testing of drug toxicity, etc. Now, endogenous renal cells, we have seen that cell, renal epithelial cells can be isolated easily from the urine of the person also. Such tubular epithelial cells can be de-differentiated into pluripotent stem cells. We have seen that they can be again reprogrammed, not only fibroblast cells, the renal epithelial cells can also be reprogrammed to form pluripotent, induced pluripotent stem cells. And there has been some studies where instead of all the four factors of the Yamanaka factor, only use of only two of them, OCT4 and SOX2. So we are not using CIMIC and KLF4. So only these two, OCT4 and SOX2, sometimes are sufficient for generation of the pluripotent stem cells. And here there is one clear advantage that we are not activating CIMIC. So the chance of generating cancer or tumor cells is again will come down some. Then the embryonic stem cells can be converted to insulin producing, typically beta cell like cells of the pancreas, and that can later be transplanted into patient of type 1 diabetes that I was discussing. So this actually is a diagram of a new pancreas that has been developed from the progenitor cells. So embryonic stem cell, progenitor, and a new pancreas has been developed. Obviously, its shape, etc., will be a little bit different, but it will be a functional endocrine pancreas that produces beta cells, that has beta cells and produces insulin. So in lung repair, lung remodeling, again, in the lung tissue diseases, there is also some work. I'll again not go into much detail. In baldness, there has been some very, very interesting result. Okay, progenitor cells, they generate the hair follicles and then they regenerate the hairs and the baldness is treated. Okay, California, there has been a work in the Aaron Potter of this is the patient Aaron Potter of the, sorry, Aaron Potter is the, my mistake, Aaron Potter is the scientist who have done this in the University of California. And you can see the difference in the regeneration of hair in this bald patient. So again, this is another very interesting thing. In dental tissue, again, regeneration of dental tissue. In fact, a new teeth has been regenerated in mice model in King College of London. So that is again another very interesting thing. Not only that, stem cell itself, a very important, very good source of stem cell can be the dental tissue, dental pulp stem cell or stem cell from the apical tissue or the apical papilla of stem cells. These are some of the typical stem cells that can be found in the dental tissue. DPSC, dental pulp stem cell, and stem cell from apical papilla of the dental tissue. So these are some of the examples where dental tissue can be taken from, stem cell can be taken from dental tissue, and dental tissue, dental damage, dental disease, dental regeneration can also be done from stem cells. So both ways. So these are just a very, very few examples, because we can go on and on and on about what are the different diseases that has been tried, because theoretically the possibility is endless. And actually work is going on. If you just go through the recent studies, you will find hundreds and hundreds of papers. So we have just mentioned few of them, mainly for the, again, I mentioned that if postgraduate trainees want to make a note, these are the topics, these are the diseases in brief or as a heading, subheading, that these are under human trial, these are under animal trial, these are established, this is the disease. So I've just enumerated some that can be written if it comes in the exam. So as the stem cell therapy and stem cell research is going on so much, there has been some level of manufacturing standard has to be set, because now it is widespread. The work on stem cell is so much widespread. So some of the regulating agencies like European Medicine Agency and Food and Drug Administration, FDA, they have set a GMP that we know as Good Manufacturing Practice Guidelines. So GMP guidelines have been set on how to produce, how to maintain, how to culture, etc. Another thing that has been made essential, I've been mentioning from last class, that these stem cells have to be xenofree. There should not be animal pathogens in there, and as little as source of animal source. So it should be ideally xenofree. Okay. So some of the xenofree culture systems that are used nowadays, just to name them, if you can remember their name, that is NutriStem with LN511 and RegES with human foreskin fibroblast. We are discussing that the fibroblast tissue from mice and fibroblast tissue from human foreskin are used as the feeder cells for the culture of stem cells. In yesterday's class, I have mentioned the role of feeder cells or feeder dependent culture of stem cells. So these are some, obviously we will favor the human foreskin fibroblast instead of the animal one, the mice one, because this is xenofree. Okay. And there are certain, somebody asked this question in the chat box at the beginning of the class, I've seen there are certain stem cell banks that have been produced, some international initiatives, some organizations. One of the most important one is National Stem Cell Bank. So they are storing different types of stem cells, different stem cell lines, and with correct amount of protocol and permission, they also can provide the stem cell lines for medical research and trial and therapeutic trial, etc. So So these are some of the stem cell banks that are internationally working for the provision of stem cell lines for the researchers. Okay. Now, obviously, there will be many ethical issues with stem cell therapy, most so with the embryonic stem cell therapy. In India specifically, the relationship is a bit complex. In India, the embryonic stem cell therapy or other stem cell therapy is not illegal. It is legal in some of the countries. I will not mention because these legal things change every day. But there are some countries, even in Europe, where stem cell research or stem cell therapy is not legal. And there are many countries in Europe also where they are legal. In India, it is legal. It is not illegal. But there are certain regulations and rules, obviously. And whenever you take the embryonic stem cells, that has a lot of ethical dilemma. Now, the thing is, Indian IVF clinics, they always have been having a lot of extra unused embryos, blastocysts in the IVF clinics. And many foreign scientists, they come here to get some of the supply of the unused embryo for their embryonic stem cell research. In fact, a term which I think is not, I say, very, very good term to have, that is, India is an embryo surplus country. Embryo surplus in the sense of IVF clinic, there is large amount of unused embryo. And foreign scientists, they often come to collect it when in their country it is the ethical regulation or the regulatory guidelines are much more stronger. So India has been supplying. So there is two sides to this story. But in 2001, which is quite a long time back, there has been a National Center of Biological Science that of government announced a crackdown on this. This is like a trade. So open trade, unregulated trade, there has been a management regulation guideline has came. Although this is quite a bit old thing, but still I thought it is worth mentioning. And then later on, as stem cell therapy has developed and progressed in India, many more guidelines have came. But again, if we try to enumerate all of them, it will be too long. Then in India right now, there are many, many, many institutes where stem cell therapy is going on. So I have just mentioned some of them. There are many, many other institutes where stem cell research and maybe therapy is also going on. Some of you may also work in some of them, but I've just mentioned some of them. So these are some examples of institutes where embryonic stem cell research is going on. Then hematopoietic stem cell and bone marrow stem cell, they are researched in many other institutes. Most are premier institutes in India. Then other neural stem cell, mesenchymal stem cell, etc., etc. All of these, there are different institutes. Again, these are not an exhaustive list. This is just a representative list. Some of the examples, there are many other institutes in India, I'm sure. So with this, we can finish the discussion on stem cells. We have discussed the biology, the culture, and the therapeutic use and prospects and research, etc. In internet, you will find a lot of material, lot of literature on this. But I have tried to sum up in a comparatively a smaller way, mainly looking at the interest of the postgraduate trainees so that they can make a note kind of thing for if there is a 10 mark question in the university exam, so they can write as much as they need. So with this, I thank you all, and over to Shamapita.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a very interesting and informative session for all the students and faculties as well. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Now it is a time for question and answer sessions. Some queries have been posted in our chat box. I will read out the question one by one. One of the participants wants to know, what is the clinical importance of stem cell bank?
The clinical importance is the stem cell banks, they are maintaining all these standards of stem cell generation and maintenance, etc. And whenever needed, I have given example of some of the international stem cell banks, and they can provide you stem cells or specific stem cell lines if you want to research on them or if you want to have a clinical trial. Obviously, we'll have to have all the ethical clearances and all the guidelines and protocols and regulations that in your country are present. But in that case, these stem cell, international stem cell banks, they can provide you with all the stem cell lines as you need. So both on the side of research as well as clinical trial, these stem cell banks can help. I think we have mentioned this in the presentation also.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, in recent instances, many of the non-diabetic COVID patients became diabetic after the recovery, even after the stoppage of steroids due to beta cell damage. So can this beta cell be targeted in the stem cell therapy?
Yeah, the thing is, theoretically, obviously, yes. The thing is, in COVID, we have seen that there are many tissue damages and cell damages post-COVID, which often, with some time, they slowly recover. So we still don't know, we don't have enough time to know that whether the beta cell damages post-COVID, they will ultimately by themselves regenerate or themselves will heal or not. In case it prolongs, obviously whenever, but obviously the large amount of beta cell damage is in type 1 diabetes. So right now study is going on in type 1 diabetes. But in other conditions, if there is a beta cell damage, obviously, there is a possibility that this can be tried, but I don't think this research is going to be in very near future. But later on, if this damage is permanent, then who knows, maybe, yes. I cannot hear you.
The next question is, what is the difference between the telomerase activity of?
Yeah, I see the question. Okay, telomerase activity of somatic cell and stem cell. Somatic cell, we know that once a cell has matured and the cell has gone into a matured specialized adult cell, in most of the cases there will not be, with few exceptions, the telomerase activity will not be there. On the other hand, the stem cell, in last class we have shown that in the two typical characters of stem cells will be on one half of their progenitor cells or one half of their daughter cells will always remain as stem cells. So they will keep their capability of regenerating or self-renewal. So that half of stem cells that continue to have the capability of renewal or self-renewal, they will continue to have the activity of the telomeres. The other half that differentiates into an adult cell, those cells, obviously, they will eventually lose out their telomerase activity mostly, with some exceptions again. But in most of the cases, as we have seen in previous class, we have shown that slide that if I can again share my slide, so we can get back to the slide. I think that will be better. So let me get back to, give me just 1 minute. In this slide, we have shown that how one stem cell divides into two types of cells. One will remain the stem cell. It will continue to have the capability to divide. And the other part will be going towards differentiation and maturation to an adult cell. And like this, as it continues to divide, one lineage of the stem cell, one of the daughter every time, will continue to have the capability of self-renewal. So that one will maintain the stem cell pool, and if it has to continue dividing, there will be the activity of telomerase will have to be maintained. On the other hand, this one that matures into different types of adult cells, obviously there will be eventually loss of activity of the telomerase. So I think
thank you, sir. Our next question is, what is the role of stem cell therapy in multiple myeloma, and how long a stem cell can be preserved, and can the rest of the member can use this stem cell for their future treatment?
The thing is that stem cell in multiple myeloma, frankly speaking, I can't tell you exactly what is the current status, so I'll have to check and only then I can come back. Now, stem cells, how they can be kept in the stem cell bank, that again depends. But we have seen that the umbilical cord, that stem cell that we were discussing today, they can be stored in the cord cell banks. Now, the exact amount of time is still, there is no, what should I say? Because it has been seen that they can be continued, but how long, we are not yet very sure. And as far as the family members using the stem cells, yes, not only family members, others can also use, but again, there will be a chance of graft versus host reaction. So if you are a close family member, that risk will be less. It's just like the transplantation of any other thing. So just like transplantation of organs, the transplantation of stem cells also will be having the similar risks of graft versus host rejection. But the beauty of stem cell here is that you can your own, even if you have an organ damaged, you can produce stem cell from your own adult cells or other cells, and then you can regenerate those tissues and those organs, and then there will be no risk of graft versus host rejection. So family members obviously can use, provided that the graft versus the immunological intolerance does not occur. Okay.
Thank you very much, sir. This is the all questions for today. Thank you once again, sir.
Okay.
It was a very informative and nice session. Thank you. Good night, sir.
Thank you, everyone.
Now, good night, sir. Now, to all the participants, if you have any queries remaining, please mail them to our official mail address, that is sslmpofficials@gmail.com. Thank you all the attendees for your warm presence and active participation. Hope to see you all again in our next online class. Good night all.